All right, ladies and gentlemen, it's good to be back again. Trust me, this has nothing to do with us being title sponsors. This was planned before we made that decision. But it's great to have an interesting panel. We curated this with the perspective that we'd have a brand, we'd have an agency. But the interesting part of the agency, it's taken me a while to understand how within the agency world, there's a creative part, there's a media buying part, and then within the media buying part, there's a creative part, and that's where Devendra comes from. And then Sameer Pitulwala was founded Culture Machine, one of the largest MCNs in the country, but does a lot more, and I'll let him explain. Now, Ajay Chakku from Array. I think what might make sense is because our landscape is so complicated. What I want to do is maybe take 30, 45 seconds just to put the video landscape into perspective, just at a 30,000 foot level. And then if Ajay, you and Sameer can specifically take that part and just give like a 1 minute take on how you see the landscape from the sort of the provider side or the companies that are playing in that space, and just sort of set that up from what you do and how that's different from what Culture Machine does, how that's different. But I think it's the high level on this is that video is exploding in India like in no other country in the world. It's beaten every estimate of every analyst. Nobody predicted that I think we'd be this rapidly edging close to 500 million people data connected. Nobody predicted that, you know, Reliance would come out so aggressively with Jio and offer free mobile bandwidth. And take a wild guess, what do people do when you give somebody who's not really experienced the internet, or even people who have experienced the internet, what do they do when they get unlimited bandwidth or cheaper bandwidth? They consume video. And so we have like a hashtag that we like called Viva Video, because we think the golden era for video is actually here. And when you have video as an option to integrate and send out your brand message, there is no other better medium, right? So from that perspective, I think we're super excited. However, from if you just look at what's happening on a demand side, there's so much of consumption. I think Google doesn't officially share this, but would be fair to say that there are upwards of 40 billion views a month now, in that range. So 40 billion views a month. I mean, that's 4,000 crores. 4,000 crore views per month on YouTube alone. And then you've got Facebook, and then you've got Hotstar, and you've got Vue, et cetera, et cetera. So just let's try and put our minds to, that's the amount of time that's getting spent on video. And then equally shocking is the amount of brand and advertiser spend that's actually going towards curating content or correlating with content here outside of the typical inventory buy piece, which is still the lion's share of everything that's happening. So at 30, 40 billion views a month on just one platform and stupendous growth, there has also been multiple genres that have emerged. It's no longer a fiefdom of comedy. Music has by far been the largest for a long time. There's food, there's auto, there's beauty, there's all kinds of dance as a genre has emerged. And I'm sure some of you will have some perspective on what might be trending. But I think, so there's some sort of a genre for any brand that is interested in sort of, you know, associating with their, or putting out their message with content. However, what we're still throwing at this problem, and I'm somewhat repetitive about this, is the big part of the spend is getting put down to the typical ad unit. The typical ad unit that all of us are waiting to press the skip ad button for, and that's how it's getting weeded out. And a small part of this entire piece, so out of the 10 or 12,000 odd crores, give or take 1,000 crores of digital spend, I think there's about a 60-40 split between search and display. So, you know, guesstimate about 4,000 odd crores going towards display and 6,000 towards search. I wouldn't challenge search because it's relevant to be online, but 4,000-5,000 crores getting spent on display advertising, which is basically your pre-rolls, your mastheads, and stuff like that. And nobody's really making a case to take that away from the platforms, simply that the format that it is appearing in could be a lot more content-centric, the kind of stuff that a brand would want, that an agency would want their brand to actually execute, and put it that way. But somehow, and that's the purpose of the discussion here, that, you know, Devendra and Kushbu will cover, that while brands also want that and the agencies would advise that, what's actually creating that divide when it actually gets executed, all right? So over to you, Ajay. I mean, if you can give a perspective, dovetail what Array does in it, but more importantly, give the audience a lay of the land, because I think it's confusing as to there's so many players. There's the and then there are creators who become large players themselves. So how do you distinguish between all of them?
So I think I had the advantage of being in different parts of the media business over the years, right? So I spent time in print in the 90s. I spent almost a decade and more in television, and now this is digital. So one thing that actually, if you were to look at that is driving the whole change, you know, one is obviously the fact that there's a lot of access-driven consumption that is happening, right? So for a lot of the people, you know, discussion around whether data costs are coming down, whether it's you know, connectivity improving, or whether new players actually, you know, getting to, you know, build this whole pipeline and, you know, give you access. So one part of the story in India has been access-driven consumption, right? The larger reality of India is a single TV household, right? So in the single TV household, there are 2.5 mobile phones already. So the other part that is driving consumption is content that is created for this, you know, excluded unit of that household, right? Which is the young adult, which is the male, which is the young female. So the whole housewife-driven, bark-driven rating system, which is actually driving TV, right, is one part of the story. The reason why a lot of people have actually kind of migrated to digital is not just because they have the access, right? It's also because there's newer forms of content that is coming, right? So that's really the, you know, overall overarching theme when it comes to why content is actually seeing this kind of explosion, why video is seeing this kind of explosion, right? So it's not just access-driven, it's also content-driven. Now, in the content side, a lot of people think that everything that has happened in the US is going to happen here. And there is a nuance change in between US and other, you know, the Indian market. The Indian market, even for high-end entertainment, has always been an ad-funded market, right? Unlike in the US where television was a subscription play, Netflix came, dropped the price, and yet got subscription revenues, right? Right. India, we've spent almost like 11 years, 12 years chasing subscription revenues. It was 20 years after the broadcast boom started.
You're saying a new avatar is Viacom 18.
Yeah, I'm talking about Network 18, Viacom 18, yep. Right? So subscription revenue positive turned about 15, 20 years after it actually was, you know, kind of in such. And that too, the best managed companies in India like Zee have almost 20, 25%, 30% coming from subscription. So India for even prime time entertainment has been an ad-funded market.
Right.
Right? Now cut that down to digital, right? So the same story is pretty much evident here, right? So bulk of whether it's Hotstar or other platforms, it's still driven by ad funding, right? It's not driven by whether it's YouTube, whether it's Facebook, whether it's Hotstar.
Sure.
Lots of people are ad funded. Now the difference between ad funding in digital and the ad funding in probably television is because of one or two important factors. I think you touched upon one or two of them, right? One, India has the highest, you know, rate of ad blockers that are pre-installed. I didn't know this. It was a Mary Meeker report. It was a revelation. I knew it was large, but I didn't know it was 28%, right? Two, couple that with ad avoidance, with fraud, and even viewability. So plain vanilla inventory advertising no longer is sufficient for the brand to be able to kind of carry out that impact, you know, that you had the option of doing in the television era.
I'm going to,
right,
pause it just 1 second. How many of you have know what an ad blocker is? Okay, and how many of you have it installed from the people who know what it is? So clearly the ad blocker is going to the base of the pyramid. I don't want to say the bottom of the pyramid,
you'd
but it's going
surprised
to the...
So the original reason why this has happened is apparently, right, because a lot of us use the UC browser and what have you, the Chinese browsers, right?
Right.
So they're like,
right,
actually...
So
using
if you
this
view
to
video on that, it's pre-blocked.
So pre-blocked to actually block out Google, I think.
But right? Do me a favor, come to the lay of the land, just so that we create a structure, and then we're going to come back. So where would you place companies that, you know, clearly there's a differentiation between the way you're seeing the market versus
So yeah,
culture
I was just coming to that. Sorry, okay. So it was a long, winding thing, but I thought you wanted to lay of the land. The full lay of the land, right? So I see content actually evolving into, you know, kind of, if you look at the current lay of the land in the content ecosystem itself, there are 3-4 kinds of people who are doing stuff. One is platforms who are trying to do content,
right?
They may acquire content, some of them may also do, you know, original content.
For example,
let's say Hotstar doing something original with like AIB or what have you, or Hotstar doing all of TV content that is online.
Okay.
Then there are guys like us that are purely focused on original content at the premium end, which means that we will do, whether it's non-fiction or fiction or whatever, we'll do long format, high value entertainment, primarily because we believe in a certain, you know, outlook for the market, which is that we believe that the market is moving to multiple genres like it has in television. We believe that people will consume, you know, stuff that is of a certain quality, which is evolving over a period of time. Then there is another layer that is actually, you know, supplying the volume layer of digital content. And then there's a fourth layer, which is actually UGC, right? So all of this is actually right now WIP. I wouldn't say there's a case for one to be better than the other or what have you, right? These are all at different stages of evolution. We've pegged ourselves at the slightly premium end of the market. That does not mean that the other ends of the market may not grow or may grow. But I'm saying the case for brand integration and content integration
is top down, you feel?
Yeah, it's top down. So
you're building it along the framework of how you would have built Network 18 back in the day, but on digital.
Yeah, we're building a content company. I mean, we are not building a platform company. I mean, if I were to put it very objectively.
Fair enough. Sameer, what's your, since Ajay has given us the long take on it, but what's your take on the landscape as it stands?
I think roughly when 4.5 years ago when we started off, there were about 60 to 70 million people on YouTube. Today there are 220 million people on YouTube. Yep. And like you said, they're doing 40 billion views a month, and that doesn't count UC web browser, it doesn't count Facebook and all the other platforms which are also all video consumption. So it's fair to say that the web is going to move more and more in terms of social towards video, if it hasn't already, especially with Instagram and Facebook leading the fray, as well as WhatsApp soon enough. I think there are about 7 major ad-supported video platforms on video on one side, and then there's about 5 subscription-based video platforms on the other side. So YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and potentially Messenger and WhatsApp on the one front, and then also UC Browse and others. And then on the right-hand side, there's Hotstar, Netflix, Amazon, and others. So that's sort of the world way the world's going, and I believe that TV will get unbundled. So there will be the FCT revenue on television, which is an advertising supported, which is going to go towards the 5 ad platforms, and the subscription revenue, which is what the likes, like you rightly said, subscription wasn't there in TV. We got subscription only once digitization started, Dash 1 happened, Dash 2 happened, Dash 3 happened, then subscription revenues became material for television. And those subscription revenues eventually, in the next many, many years, TV linearly is not going anywhere, but eventually the subscription revenues will go to Netflix and Amazon. So I believe TV will be left with 2 of its core business models unbundled from where it is. And why will this happen? Because you are sitting on a population of 400 million people between 18 to 35, is the youngest millennial population in the world, higher than China. That is going to go to 500 million by 2020. Of that 500 million, 75% of whoever's working actually runs their households. So millennials who work are actually running their households, which means that if you, and they don't, you know, necessarily, they do, may still, I mean, I have a bunch of millennials, many millennials which work at Culture Machine, and it's not like they don't watch TV. It's a habit. They actually coincidentally also end up reading newspapers. But the fact of the matter is that the majority of the consumption habits are led by the feed, whether it's on YouTube or Facebook. So it's just the demographic dividend of this country and the way the technology's frameworks are, it's inevitable that more and more people will end up watching it, and hence there will be more pressures on the television viewership business. So that's the 30,000 feet. How do we fit into that? We run 5 media brands in India, each one amongst the highest in terms of viewership, whether for North, it's Being Indian. For Telugu, we run Viva, Put Chutney in Tamil, Awesome Sauce in Food, and obviously Blush in terms of women, and Being Indian for the North. So those are the 5 media brands we run. And our idea was of technology to build at the creation level, not at the distribution level. So our 2 core tech platforms actually, which we retail worldwide now with WPP as well, and have great clients in the form of Levers and others, help understand content, what exact content to create, and also including which influencers to create it with, and then create that content at scale. So those are, you know, stacks which we use ourselves as a media company, and today do about 1 billion views a month. And those core technology platforms are also what we work with clients internationally in order to retail them. So the way we look at it is that, you know, these 5 media brands, we have seen tremendous growth in viewership, especially from regional markets. And I think with the way that we are seeing Tamil, Telugu, where we are seeing, brands like, we run one of the largest brands on devotional on Facebook as well. Brands, I think what's happening is with Jio coming on board, Bharat has come on board when it comes to watching content. So Haryanvi content, Bhojpuri content, entertainment within those genres, comedy within those genres, music obviously within those genres, all of those sort of sub-verticals within this Cambrian explosion of content on the internet is what's happening. And certain creators, when they become mature enough, like an AIB was a creator, became mature enough as a business, hence became a media business. And I believe that's true of, you know, how we are. We end up being people who end up running media businesses, but, you know, have gone the other way of the spectrum. And I think that's pretty much it, the difference.
I think that's really the future. I think all the companies, us included, you know, whichever slice or whichever slant you have of it will eventually go to a cross-media platform. Well, not necessarily a platform, but a new definition of platform, but a media business rather than... And I think the platforms also will emerge, not necessarily just being housed in digital. The larger you get, you will also see back into some of the traditions.
I think it's also a point of view that today it's not just a YouTube game, right? So when in the initial, you run an MCN, our media brands are fully owned by us. So in certain cases, the whole model was predicated on, hey, these are large YouTube influencers or these are large Instagram influencers. So if you're doing beauty, it's very hard to plan media when your editorial voice of your brand can be changed because you have to do 10 creators here, 10 creators on YouTube, 10 creators on Facebook. So I think it's the difference, I guess, just to kind of delineate between an influencer and a media brand is having a consistent voice across all ad supported platforms. So if you look at an Array or look at a BI or maybe in your case, in a FunQ for that matter, they might be consistent on two platforms or three platforms. And I think that's the big distinctions. Running a media business today is a full-time job when it comes to creating content for and being engaged. When we do about 1 billion views a month, it becomes hard enough for us to just be able to consistently create content. And I think our technology tools obviously help us a lot to produce content programmatically, whether it's vertical video, horizontal video, square-shaped video. The formats are so much more different. And like, for example, when a brand like Put Chutney goes to TV on Star Vijay, you have to recreate that entire framework. It's the old school way of telling a story, but it's still in terms of framework very different. So I think that's the challenge today is, I think for any creator, it's either you work in your own private island called a platform and become really big on that.
Yep.
But the difference is when you become a media brand, you've got to scale to multiple platforms.
Good. If you want to jump in over here, and Khushbu, we're coming to you really quick. So I think one of the key things, and maybe there are 2-3 parts to this answer, and you could pick a couple of them, because I think this theme will come back again in our conversation. You know, there's this big gap between the boardroom conversations that we all have and at conferences like this about digital being the future, video being the lead, you know, this massive ecosystem of content creators, of media brands available, this new breed. And then there seems to be this gap between the boardroom conversation and execution. And you obviously, you know, have great insights into, and you're working with the brands. And I know from, you know, the brands themselves, I'm sure, wanted to do this. Where's the crack? Why isn't it translating much, much faster than it is today?
Essentially, you're saying, why not more conversions? You know, why don't we see more and more brands embracing this?
Embracing this at scale. I mean, so everybody will say they have a digital strategy. Nobody doesn't have a digital strategy because they'd be, you know, out of the game. But what they're actually doing between what is said at a boardroom and a business plan kind of a strategy session to actual execution still tends to be more of the same. Versus, so how are brands evolving? I don't know. You'd know this. Like if the platforms have grown 200% in a year, is the digital spend even, it was projected to go 30%, 35%, is it going to become a 70% growth at least, if not 150%? I mean, it should be 150% logically, but is it even going to become 50, 60% higher? I don't see that directly happening.
Fair. See, so I think let me put it this way. You want to do content because you know you want to tell your brand story, right? And every brand wants to do that, right? That ends up creating a lot of relevance and you know it actually takes up your mind measures. The only thing is, and probably I think agencies also are taking blame on this, which is that none of the pitches are really you know, outcome focused. It's more about, you know, at the end of the day, okay, you will get these many views or these million impressions, right? Problem really there is that for that he's anyways, you know, doing his media plans, right? So what are the outcomes that the content is going to deliver, right? And there's no formula, there's no really measurement, you know, that has gone. So clearly the questions and the pushback that we also get is, okay, great idea, but what will it do? So on one end, you know, you have a set metrics which they're used to, you know, your share of voice, you know, that they'll keep on tracking week on week versus, you know, suddenly there's a great idea. And like Ajay was also mentioning premium content, and by premium, I mean, even the cost of the content is high, right? So
that's all he meant by premium.
Exactly.
So no, I'm just kidding.
So why should I invest a few crores on something which I don't know what the outcome will be? So then that's I think where the lacuna is. So unless we bridge the whole measurement and, you know, bring some sanity to the approach, I think this will continue.
Khushbu, it's been passed on to you. The brands are asking for all of this, but and they're asking for measurement, and it's largely around from the traditional formats. It's about reach, it's about views. We talk about the engagement rates, but eventually does it boil down to just reach and views? I know you do the influencer marketing piece, and I want you to do more digital influences, but where is it?
Fundamentally, right now, I think it's a good time to be for brands, because if you hear the landscape that both Ajay and Sameer mapped out, it's a problem of plenty. It's about brands being able to make the right choices, because the choices that were there compared to 5 years back have grown significantly today. Now it's just about brands understanding that which is the best choice, because your investment kitty is not going to go up just because, you know, options have gone up. So then it's about choosing between a platform, like a television platform, which gives you a very focused M&E on your investments, vis-a-vis putting, say, branded content, doing integrations within the brand. Now, those are the choices where today, you know, some part of the decision has to still be intuitive. And the intuitiveness comes from a lens saying that, hey, I'm doing a content integration. Will people even remember my brand within the integration, vis-a-vis me running TV spots or, you know, taking YouTube inventory straight out? So I think till that doesn't get clearly defined, I think still there's going to be a certain amount of ambiguity in terms of decision making for the brands.
Isn't there some part of apples and oranges there? Because I mean, you'd see a TV campaign and it's massive reach, it's massive frequency, and of course it's a big budget. But then you compare that to maybe a season of a IP with Array, or, you know, or something that we might do with a creator. But at best, it's a few episodes and then it goes. And so you don't get that impact versus the money that you're spending on TV. So, but yet the expectation is to deliver a brand lift or to deliver a saliency score that is comparable to what TV is delivering. Isn't that a challenge then, the expectation
really,
mapping?
No, expectation mapping is not really a challenge. I think when you're making a choice to invest in a digital piece of content, I think your expectations are realistically mapped to the kind of investment going on into the piece and also the duration of the piece that's going to be live. So I think from an expectation perspective, I would be very surprised if like a marketing manager or brand manager turns around and says that, hey, we wanted to deliver the same as television. But I think what the ambiguity sits is a little in understanding whether, you know, if my brand is integrated within this piece of content, will people remember the piece of content, but whether they will remember my brand or not. So that's where the ambiguity in judgment comes in for brands.
Okay.
But having said that, I think a lot of brands are making these choices today. I think everybody is understanding there is a need for us to be more forward-looking, even though today there might not be an understanding on how, you know, the integrations will work for the brand, but the risk appetite is growing. So I think that's a very positive thing.
So I think we're all seeing that. I mean, this side of the, we're all seeing that. It's just that, you know, as I say, dil mange more. And commensurate to the speed at which it's growing. Devendra, I'm not trying to put you on the spot. I know it's not directly what you do, but you would have some insight in this. In the vast marketing budget of a large company, okay, say companies that have upwards of 400-500 crores to spend on marketing in a year, what percentage of that is devoted towards digital content marketing? Roughly, is it what percentage? Is it single-digit percentage, double-digit percentage, small single-digit percentage?
So are you talking about digital advertising, digital content marketing?
No, content marketing. Content marketing in the sense, in the true sense of content marketing, because, I mean, we've established the hypothesis or the case, the thesis that there is this entire community that's growing, engaging, largest millennial population in the world, hungry to watch that content, blah, blah, blah. But can we get a new mic for Ajay so that, okay. So,
in the avoidance part.
Right. So, in that context, given that the opportunity is large, we know that digital is still 10 out of the 55,000-60,000 crore spend, right? And it's growing at 30%. So you're already talking about a 15, 16%, maybe 20%. Okay, of that 20%, because the bulk is going to search and display, what do you see, without naming a company or divulging anything that might be confidential, what's the range? Is it 1%, 5% that is going towards content marketing? Because I feel that it's a really, really a fraction of what is happening. Is that a correct notion, or is that misplaced?
Yeah, so without you know, going advertiser by advertiser,
sure.
But largely, and if I include social, everything, sorry, social is a part of it,
yeah.
I think it would hover somewhere between 3 to 6%.
5 to 6%?
3 to
6%.
3 to 6%, yeah. Okay. Sameer, do you think it's about there, or?
I think it will be, I honestly think they don't even think about it. It will be a subset of the digital spend.
Correct.
So it won't be like, okay, content marketing, and a lot has to do with the fact like, you know, when Jio happened and YouTube's viewership bumped up, the inventory levels dropped because advertisers and agencies don't react as fast as consumers do.
Fill rates also dropped.
And yeah. In general, because it's not like now, in fact, there should be more spending, but you'll see the effects, I guess, in Q2.
We actually talked about that in the last panel with Riksha Rale, where we're seeing on YouTubers, you know, the revenue, views going up.
Yeah,
versus TV, you typically see TRPs going up and then an increase in ad rates, but here you have the reverse of that.
Yeah, and it's actually true. A billion views 4 years ago would make you 6 times more money than what it will make you today.
Absolutely.
So it's only, in fact, going to get worse, because as Facebook becomes bigger and more inventory revenue goes there, inventory revenue will get further fragmented. It's going to be hard to be a creator subsisting only on that.
So a percentage of the digital spend, so say out of the 15-odd%, maybe 10% goes there. So ballpark 2-3% on the lower side of that spectrum. And that's fundamentally the challenge, right?
Less than a third of the digital spends are going to content.
Yeah.
That's pretty much.
Much less, yeah. So what can we do? I mean, then either we are failing at communicating the story, because the brands seem to be wanting to do it. This is the puzzle, right?
No, I don't think the brands are necessarily just going. I think at the end of the day, a brand manager's job is to, while its salience and growing share of voice and all is there, at the end of the day, his mandate to the agency is help me grow sales by creating great creative. It's something where, you know, I remember when I was in Times, Bhaskar Das used to say that, you know, all the flirting is nice, but where is the actual, you know, four-letter word, which is the fact of the matter is when you put
love
an ad.
You mean?
When
he's looking for love?
Yeah, he is looking for love.
Right.
When you put in a print ad, your calls go off the hook. When you put a TVC, you can actually, you know, look at a
so
material
what's the
change.
To dhanda? Product
exactly.
Is right?
The same thing happens with YouTube and Facebook. When they go to the narrative today on why you should advertise with them, there's a clear sense in terms of connecting inventory buy on Facebook and YouTube and being able to see a lift in sales. And their internal studies with levers, etc., especially with YouTube and TrueView, have shown that there's a material impact on sales if you buy the masthead on YouTube. You know, PepsiCo, Shiv Kumar keeps talking about how it actually is the cheapest unit to buy than buying the front page of a newspaper. Now, I think for us, thankfully for a lot of brands we work with, whether it's Astro in Malaysia with Video Machine or whether it is with Tinder over here, there is a material impact, but those stories do not get told because attribution is so hard. If you have done a branded content or you have done a branded content with the creator, it's not like the brand is actually closing the loop and saying, hey, by the way, thank you for this. And I saw a bump via X. There are one or two studies possibly done with Millward Brown or Kantar, which actually look at this. There's not enough of research done to show that branded content has a material impact on sales. We sell our own merchandise on Being Indian. So I know for a fact that at least when I sell my own product, if we put a video and we integrate it, I immediately see a bump in the sales on my merch. But that's internal to me. It's not something if I do it for Tinder or if I do it for any of your brands. And I think work has to be done as an industry to show that connection. Because if that data isn't there, it's so hard for them. I can understand the hesitance they have in spending money.
No, you've been a big proponent of this research. Can we get one more mic here by any chance? If we can just...
No, I think Sameer, we have...
You share a mic? Okay. Yeah. I was... Okay. So...
Yeah. So, before that, I'll just add to... Yeah. I mean, every day it might not be sales, you know, which the brands are really targeting. But like I said earlier as well, that unless, you know, there's some sanity to, you know, what really we are trying to measure and, you know, what is it delivering, you know, this lacuna will always exist.
If it's not sales, it's virality, right? It's the the archetypal viral content and the views.
Right.
And it's one of the two. It's never impact. It's seldom engagement because it's so hard to track and sort of do that attribution as Sameer was saying. So, but you've been, you know, in our conversations, you've talked about how, you know, one needs to build the equivalent to measure impact of content
right.
At a softer level and not just of views and watch time is great, but maybe it's still not giving you enough information. Right. And there needs to be a benchmark. I mean, we can all come up with something and present it, but it'll be somewhat biased.
Right.
So at the agency side, and is that happening at any speed or?
It is, actually it is. You know, so a lot of our advertisers now are actually earmarking a percentage of, you know, their content spends only on measurement. Yeah, yep. And that is, I mean, and that's a part of the process. Yeah.
And so, would you say that is 20% of your client base, 50% of your client base so far? Is it small right now?
Sorry?
The people who are doing this, you're marking it, is it across the board? Is it something that you're mandating that you need to do this?
I would say all across all the top clients that we have,
it's
the
happening.
Top 20%, yeah, I mean, most of them are.
Okay,
some are doing it as a process, some might be, you know, on a project-to-project basis.
Right.
A lot of our advertisers are still focused on a lot of hero content.
Right.
But people who have, you know, who are constantly, you know, churning out content as a part of, you know, their strategy,
right.
They're definitely investing a lot in the measurement as well.
Sameer, I would like to make a call out. Yeah. I think what from a brand lens is also very important to understand is that the way the creators are on a journey to grow themselves, brands are also on a journey to understand how this new mediums work. Today, I mean, there was a point when a marketer would ask the agency person, mujhe viral video banana hai. I don't think that question comes anymore because people understand that the concept of viral video is an urban myth now. So I think brands are also learning how to work with creators. Today, brands would want to work with creators in a way that the content they create with them has a lot of authenticity to it. Like if today I want to work with, say, like an AIB or an EIC, I want their voice on the table. If I'm going to ask them to only put out my brand's voice on the table, then I might as well do it as an ad unit.
Right.
But to come to a middle point where, you know, a brand learns how to factor in the creator's point of view and come to a place which works for both of them,
right.
Is a place where brands are still learning to reach. I mean, today you see a lot of, like, you know, say when people are working with digital influencers, and I'm sure like your talent would have, you know, talked it out among themselves.
Yep.
They would give like a written text with a photo saying, you know, please post it on your handles. And that is all our expectation is. So you're looking at creator as not a creator, but as somebody who has a reach. So, and which is not the correct way to look at it if you want them to help you build a cultural voice for your brand. So
got
I think for brands, it's a journey.
Got it. While we're still with you, I wanted to address or put one question to you. Can you talk about the journey on how your relationship with the agencies is evolving? You know, it's always been creative media buying, creative production house media buying. How is that relationship evolving? And then as Diageo, you guys have also taken this whole thing from, you know, brands being advertisers to brands being publishers, whether it swung to the other end of the spectrum where you started saying, we'll create all the content, we'll become the destination. And some people have had success, but most can't sustain that. To now brands being a partner, a co-IP owner, and letting the creators do the creation, but coming on board with that. So how does that all work with your agency partners? And how's the agency relationship involved in doing all of this?
I think we are on a transition journey as far as the agency relationships are concerned. So there are certain parts of an agency relationship which will continue to exist in the same format. Say like a relationship, for example, with the media buying team at Mindshare. Now that's a relationship which has existed in a certain format and it will continue to exist in a certain format,
right.
In the same format. But there are some parts as far as the creative agencies are concerned that are transitioning today. So today when a brand's expectation is saying that, I think brands are moving from an expectation saying that I want the best from what my agency has to saying that I want the best. I don't care who comes to me with the best idea on
the
table.
Can you contextualize this with the Yari No. 1 thing that you guys have done in Telugu? Or is that something that you can share with the audience? Or is that?
Devin, why don't
you
start?
Okay, so just taking the point from there.
Yeah.
Yes, I mean, you know, so content even as a part of media, you know, sometimes advertisers also don't want to look at us, right? So are we creative or, you know, should they be only looking at effectiveness from us?
Yeah.
But like I said, you know, with some of our advertisers, you know, we have, the transition is already there or has already happened. So, I mean, on Yari number one, So for McDowell's.
And if you can call out in that the nature of the relationship, how that's evolved, as in.
I mean, it's clearly, I think we have acted as more like, you know, marketing partners as far as that journey is concerned. Right.
Right.
It's it was just not about launching a show, but, right. You know, right from it being a new template to, you know, a new template of marketing as well, you know, which starts from, you know, activating their trade to, you know, the final culmination into the show, right?
So it's become a TV show now.
It's become a TV show. I don't know whether you call it a TV show or an OTT show because, you know, if you look at numbers on both are excellent. Right,
so it's on OTT and it's on TV. And I understand it's a high rated TV show and it's doing well.
It's the highest rated TV show. I think it's getting rated at number 10. The OTT views are at about 20 million, 26 million as we speak. So, and these are huge numbers.
And whose concept was this? Is this something that you hashed out the concept together with the brand?
Yeah. Okay. So, I mean, the brand all.
Yeah, so just so McDowell's basically at Diageo, the way we look at marketing, it's a very purpose led marketing model. So where we believe that each brand stands for a certain purpose, and the way the brand needs to show up in the culture is in the context of that purpose. So for McDowell's, at a trademark level, we believe that the brand is all about celebrating the bonds of brotherhood, which is about yari, friendship. It's not the friends, and I've got Abhishek here, who's my marketing manager on McDowell's. So he can offline elaborate more if people want to know. But fundamentally, the brand talks about yari, friendship and close bonds of brotherhood. Now, a show like Number One Yari with Rana is a show about celebrating some of the relationships that Rana has with people from Telugu industry. And, you know, the whole content piece is centered around bringing, you know, the vibe of friendship and yari coming out.
That's how you've integrated the brand value.
Yeah.
But how is the model different? So you are co-IP owners in that versus being the main publishers versus being the sponsor.
So it is not a AFP model. We are not looking at it as, you know, just being a logo presence on the content. It's a co-owned IP that we've developed.
So you have an upside in it as it sort of evolves into another season and stuff like that.
And Mindshare team brought
it. At the end of the day, it's rooted in popular culture. It's what, you know, people followed movie stars. You know, it's completely rooted in that. And a lot of brands, at the end of the day, you know, want to speak to these audiences.
Right.
So, you know, it's a co-owned IP, but of course there are other brands also, you know, who are participating in this.
So, really quickly, creatively, I think India has been right up there in terms of creative output. On digital, I'm not so sure that we're really at the cutting edge of it yet. Have you, in your experiences, how do you do thought leadership? I'm sure at WPP, you must have some program. What have you seen internationally on digital specifically that is something that you wish we could do better in India from a content, brand, content creator, agency coming together?
See, I think from a creative perspective, I think we have done some kick-ass stuff, right? If I take examples like, you know, the six-pack band that we did last year, or, you know, the Dove video, you know, that we did.
Right.
But internationally, you know, when I have interacted with my counterparts, I think it's a great blend of, you know, creativity and technology coming together. Right, and there was this interesting case that I saw recently when from my American counterpart. So it was about the launch of a car, right? And clearly a car which is not there in the mindset of the millennials, and it was meant for the millennials.
Do you remember what it was? Which car?
The brand?
Yeah,
it was Volvo.
Okay.
Yeah, and they were launching a special variant for the millennials.
Okay.
Right, now... So, you know, Mindshare came up with this concept and, you know, they shot a great action film, you know, which brought about the attributes of the car.
Okay.
Yeah, with an action star and a Hollywood director. Now, yes, even we can do that, right?
So, premium content, Ajay.
But at the venue, you know, when they had a potential customer walking in, you know, they would take him, they would shoot him in 5 or 7 different angles. And then in the final video, you know, that hero gets substituted by this guy.
So it looks like that customer was actually driving
that
car.
He's driving it. Now, and you know, millennials,
they
love to share, right? They love to propagate. So video where you have, you know, you are a part of a chase, you know, imagine the virality that it would have created.
Cool content. Sam, do you want to, I don't want to have time, but we'll stretch it a little bit. Give us an example of something really innovative on the distribution front. I think on the creative front, it's up for grabs and how it landed. But on the distribution front, any innovative distribution techniques that you've deployed, or where tech's been integrated or otherwise?
Yeah, Yeah, so I think when you build out these brands, the idea is to have a deep community with a certain TG. So for example, Blush, we can grow it to have more numbers, but we take a lot of care that 90% of all the audiences on that are female. Because it's easy to add in a pop country like India, male audiences really rapidly, but it dilutes the brand's core audience. Now, on that, something we did recently it is a combination of two things. We actually, with Pantaloons, where with Video Machine, it can automatically take any storyboard and automate it. So there was a story which we created on WhatsApp between a mother and a daughter, and used the Facebook marketing API to actually look at remarketing to existing Blush audiences. But that all, when we put the content out there, we didn't put a single piece of money in there, and it grew organically to 4.5 million views. That video took us roughly about 6 minutes to produce, and it looks great because it's actually a fabulous looking video of that. And in that case, it's actually a conversation between a mother and a daughter while the daughter is at the Pantaloons showroom. All of this is happening over WhatsApp. It's a video, and the daughter actually sends across.
So they're exchanging messages. They're exchanging messages.
It's not actually a video, but yeah. The whole video is nothing but the WhatsApp format. I think Array also does something similar, which is take over your phone, except we automated it. So the point is that she actually starts sending pictures from the showroom to the mother over WhatsApp, and that was coming from Pantaloons as a brand. So the main part was the ability to take a creative, really quickly turn it around and put a video out there and then make sure that it reaches the right TG. I think not enough of focus sometimes is done when you might get 4.5 million views, but if you're a brand targeting women on Mother's Day, look at what the TG is. If it's going to be 80% male audiences who are engineering from North India, it's of no use for you. You know, that is going to be, it doesn't do anything for your brand. So I think especially when it comes to cohorts like that, it's very valuable to be able to use the product marketing APIs that a lot of these brands provide and then marry that with the creative.
2 minutes, yeah. Ajay, a quick bite on what can we do better on digital from your learnings of, 20 years in TV? You survived the entire, I think the belt when print was bigger than TV, right?
Yeah.
2002, 2003.
Yeah. So we tried to sell genres like business when it was not even there.
So, I guess you should remind us that people have forgotten that now when we are seeing TV is much bigger than digital, that time will come perhaps where those tables turn too. But in the late 90s, it was TV was clamoring for attention.
Yeah, absolutely.
So what happened then that actually shifted it, or was it just the mass adoption that eventually?
One obviously is the simple point of wherever the consumer goes, everything will follow, right? Whether it's subscription or advertising revenue, that follows. The other point, I think, taking it from her and the distribution point we're talking about, right? Today, we don't have a league table. Today, if you look at television, you clearly have a league table saying, okay, IPL is the number one watch property at any point of time, or Balika Vadhu is there, or five other shows are there. And different segments have different league tables, right? What are people actually watching? What are people consuming? Now, if you look at an example of somebody like Array, or somebody who's actually a broadcaster who's got an OTT platform as well, right? The ability to measure across platforms, and the data points that are coming across for a unit of content is not there. So therefore, we don't really know today, as in public domain at least. I know what that number is for my shows, but we don't know what is the league table in digital. What are really people consuming across age groups, across demographics, across geographies? Like, is there on TV? However flawed that methodology is, but it's there, right? So whether it's Bach or Nielsen, whoever does that unit content level of measurement, I think that is a good starting point for people to understand, hey, digital is actually now, people are watching a digital show much more than all of television put together. Right? We really have only anecdotal data or data from YouTube or Facebook.
You should subscribe to our intelligence machine. We just open up to publishers. We'll give you that lead table.
Everybody you should make it published every week. Please put out a lead table, right?
That's not a bad idea. In fact, we're just thinking about doing that. Probably mid of next month, we'll launch intelligence machine rankings, which are actual rankings for influencers and creators.
My point is that at a simplistic level also, I think people have not got enough of that scale available to them to kind of analyze or understand.
Now, before we have more plugs from Sam, we'll take it. We'll push it to the. Any questions? I think we can take a couple of questions before we. It's a really interesting panel, ladies and gentlemen. I think you should ask some hard questions. Who's up for a question? All right then. I guess you guys are around. I'm sure you'll get hounded offline. Thank you very much. We'll call it a close for today. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to request Sameer to please present the mementos to all the panel members as well.
Sure. That's it. That's okay.